Good morning and welcome to Tenth this morning. It is for all of us here today, friends and family and church family, a most solemn and sorrowful occasion. Kit and JD and the girls are very grateful to you for joining with them on this harrowing occasion. And we come this morning to find confidence, to find our faith built up and renewed in the Word of God. We have nowhere else to go. Disciples once said to Jesus, "You alone have the words of eternal life." And it is to Jesus, as he's revealed himself, and to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus that we come this morning. And to hear the Word of God, first of all, in terms of an affirmation from Psalm 22. He has not despised or abhorred the affliction of the afflicted, and he has not hidden his face from him, but he has heard when we cried to him. Or again, these great words from Isaiah 41 and verse 10. "Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you by my righteous right hand." And then, most splendid of all, the basis of our confidence, even in this grief-laden event this morning, from 1 Peter chapter 1. "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. According to his great mercy, he has caused us to be born again to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who by God's power are being guarded through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time." Let's pray together. And our Father, as we come to you this morning, we can scarcely breathe for grief as it weighs down heavily upon us, and cannot even begin to imagine the weight of that grief on the hearts of this family whom we love and treasure, who are with us today. We are overwhelmed. They must be overwhelmed in a way that we cannot even grasp. We are with them in our hearts. We want to comfort them, but must look beyond one another, first of all to you, because you alone are the God of all comfort. You are the Father of mercies. And to our Lord Jesus, who took our humanity and who lived in our humanity, and in our humanity was put to death, and in our humanity was raised from the dead and lives in the power of an endless life, our only hope, our risen and reigning Lord Jesus Christ. And we pray that in his resurrection we might find our hope rekindled, our faith revitalized, and even the beginnings of a deep-seated joy restored. We pray, Father, that you help us to be realistic today, that we cannot easily or quickly get rid of memories, nor will we want to, or place aside the sense of loss, nor would we care to. But in the midst of it all, we would meet with you. We ask that you would meet with us, in Jesus' strong name. Amen.
Please be seated. We have a medley of scripture verses this morning, some which I'll just introduce very easily in each section. The first is the scripture that JD and Kit read to Stephen when he was born and continued to read to him from Jeremiah 1. Now the word of the Lord came to me saying, "Behold, I formed you in the womb, I knew you. And before you were born, I consecrated you. I appointed you a prophet to the nations." Then I said, "Ah, Lord God, behold, I do not know how to speak, for I am only a youth." But the Lord said to me, "Don't say I'm only a youth, for to all to whom I send you, you shall go. And whatever I command you, you shall speak. Do not be afraid of them, for I am with you to deliver you, declares the Lord." Then the Lord put out his hand and touched my mouth. And the Lord said to me, "Behold, I have put my words in your mouth. See, I have set you this day over nations and over kingdoms to pluck up and to break down, to destroy and to overthrow, to build and to plant." And then from Stephen's memory work, these were the verses that he had memorized and he gave before the summertime broke. The children in the church learn scripture verses as well as the catechism, and they memorize all of these and send them. And these are the ones that he enjoyed. Isaiah 40, verse 8, "The grass withers, the flowers fade, but the word of our God will stand forever." Psalm 100, verse 5, "For the Lord is good, his steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations." And John 14, 1, "Let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God, believe also in me." And then just a few verses from Psalm 27 that we read on Saturday. "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? One thing have I asked of the Lord, that will I seek after, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. Hide not your face from me. Turn not your servant away in anger, O you who have been my help. Cast me not off. Forsake me not, O God of my salvation. I believe that I shall look upon the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait for the Lord. Be strong and let your heart take courage. Wait for the Lord." And then from Matthew 18, which is our text for our homily today. "At that time, the disciples came to Jesus saying, 'Who's the greatest in the kingdom of heaven?' And calling to him a child, he put him in the midst of them and said, 'Truly I say to you, unless you turn and become like children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. Whoever humbles himself like this child is the greatest in the kingdom of heaven."
Thank you.
It's wonderful to be able to have perspective on Stephen. He was young, he was lively, and we thought, you know, his Bible school teachers might be great people to give us insight, and so it's wonderful to have the Waltons here, both David and Karen.
Jesus said to them, "Let the little children come to me. Do not hinder them."
Jesus said to them, "Let the little children come to me. Do not hinder them, for to such belongs the kingdom of God." It has been our privilege for the past 7 years to teach the four-year-old Sunday school class here at 10th. Together we study through the life of Christ. Week after week, like the parents in the New Testament, 10th parents bring their little children to Jesus. And this is where we begin our remembrance of Stephen. We remember how Kit and JD very faithfully brought Stephen here to church, to Sunday school, entrusting him to us for 1 hour in order that he might be introduced to Jesus. Before each lesson, we prayed with these precious little ones together that we might hear Jesus' words, understand them, and do what he said. This is how even little children may glorify God, by loving him and doing what he commands. Stephen's faithful attendance taught him this and even more. By joining with the covenant community on a weekly basis, Stephen was learning the joy of meeting with God's people in God's house. I remember with fondness the occasional morning when JD would, while bringing Stephen to the classroom, would glance down in surprise and say, "Oh, I didn't know he was wearing that." He dressed himself today. Stephen had chosen his favorite shirt, which had become about an inch too short in the sleeves. Whose heart wouldn't melt at that evidence of budding independence? But what impressed me was this. Stephen was already participating in preparation for family and community worship.
As part of the four-year-old Bible memory program, Stephen learned Psalm 122:1. "I was glad when they said to me, 'Let us go to the house of the Lord.'" Whenever I heard a child recite this verse, I would ask them, "What is the house of the Lord? Do you know that means church?"
Were you glad this morning when Mom and Dad said it was time to go to church? And by the twinkle in his eye and the ready grin on his face, I believe I can say that Stephen was. He was also glad to hide God's word in his heart. Stephen faithfully participated in 10th Bible memory program and was eager to complete all the verses for the year. As he practiced his verses at home and recited them at Sunday school, he was coming to embrace the Bible as the book for him. And I think that was one of his favorite songs to sing in Sunday school, the one that goes like this. "The B-I-B-L-E, yes, that's the book for me. I stand alone on the word of God, the B-I-B-L-E." And then we'd say, "Bible." Of course, we always sang it through twice, and we added a twist. At the end of the first stanza, we'd whisper, "Bible," as quietly as we could. But at the end of the second stanza, we would shout it as loud as we liked. As you may guess, many of the children loved shouting very loud, but none more than Stephen. I will forever picture him in my mind, eyes squeezed shut, fists over his ears, shrieking, "Bible," at the top of his lungs. And that brings us to our final thought. As much fun as we would have with singing well-known favorites like "Jesus Loves Me," hymns such as "Holy, Holy, Holy," and "What Can Wash Away My Sin," and some more contemporary children's choruses, we tried to never lose sight of the ultimate purpose, training our children to worship. Jesus himself declared in Matthew 21 that he has ordained praise from the mouth of children and infants. We know very well that when we teach these children words of faith, words of praise, words of trust, we are teaching them words beyond their full comprehension, ideas that are too great for them to fully understand. Sometimes our songs include metaphors which 4- and 5-year-olds find difficult to grasp. They find it hard to move beyond the literal and see the larger spiritual significance. And so sometimes it seems do we. One of the last songs Stephen ever sang with our Sunday school class has taken on a heartbreaking significance in these last days. It went like this. Whether it rains, whether it pours, wherever I go, I will trust you, Lord. In the light of day or in the dark of night, I will trust you, Lord, with all my life. Today the tables are turned. It is you and I who struggle to see past the storm. We cannot fully comprehend the truths that we profess. This night for us feels very dark. But Stephen now knows only the light of day. We understand in part, but he understands fully. He has been ushered into the presence of Jesus to do exactly what Kit and JD, what we in some small way prepared him to do. To know Christ, to be glad in the house of the Lord, to delight in God's words, and to sing, even shriek, in joyful worship. He has completed the work God gave him to do, but you and I have not. So as long as we remain, let's encourage one another through our tears and to sing as Stephen would if he were here. Whether it rains, whether it pours, wherever I go, I will trust you, Lord. In the light of day or in the dark of night, I will trust you, Lord, with all my life.
I'm not sure if Tommy Kirkpatrick is secondary mom, tertiary mom. I'm not sure what her title is, but she's been a part of Stephen's life all the time. And so it's delightful to have her come and share some memories.
Is the baby sharing as well?
The little family first walked into our lives soon after we moved to Pennsylvania, or more like waddled into our lives. Kit and I were both very pregnant with our 4th children when we bumped into each other at a homeschooling conference. She had been a parent longer, she had been a homeschooler longer, and she had lived in this area longer. So I attached myself to her. I desperately wanted a mentor. What I didn't know was that I'd be gaining such a dear friend. So it was only a matter of time before our husbands and children became friends. They had no choice. Stephen and my son Sam spent once a week together in a nursery setting, and that eventually turned into occasional play dates, which turned into regular play dates, which turned into buddies, which turned into best friends. The kind of boyhood friendship that contained glorious amounts of mud and mischief, fighting and laughing, and ridiculous amounts of snacks. Stephen became such a regular presence in our family that even I would find myself missing him if we hadn't seen him that week. I may have even called Kit to ask if he wanted a play date because we missed him. There was just something about him. Those fiery eyes, that head of hair, that raspy voice. My home and our hearts are marked with beautiful memories of Stephen. The way he'd proudly present a homemade gift to Sammy when he walked through the door. The camouflage bandana with the glittery puff paint is my favorite, and I think the girls might have had something to do with that. The way he and Sammy would march through the rose bushes and hydrangeas in our backyard, as tall as they were, slaying imaginary monsters for hours. The songs they would compose on the keyboard and drums. There was one about taking over the world. It was classic. The way Stephen would run and hide in our basement when Kit would come to pick him up. In his deep, raspy, unusually loud voice yelling, "I'm not going." He had a great angry voice, Kit. The way they would hug and yell, "I love you," to each other, so innocently after a play date, or compulsively give away a favorite toy to each other, and we'd secretly be happy if it was a big, bulky, loud one. How many times did Kit and I sit at the kitchen table, or stand at the front door, or in the driveway, or at a playground, or over a much-needed glass of wine, essentially asking the same question over and over. What do we do with these boys? Is it normal that they turn everything into a weapon? Is it okay that they are so competitive and argumentative that they almost seem to be looking for a fight? Should we be concerned that they find bodily functions hysterical? And that they instinctively turned one of our school's history sentences about the liberators of South America from "they fought" to "they fart"? So many questions. Such uncharted territory. And here we are now, with a heaping pile of new questions, with a flood of tears attached to each one. Such uncharted territory. But I have hope that the God who guided you into raising and loving Stephen up to his last breath will guide you into releasing and remembering him up to your last breath. Stephen gave my family the gift of adventure, first fights, first sleepovers, half-eaten apples. He gave us the gift of boyhood friendship, of brotherly love, and a deeper understanding of our hope in Jesus. Our sons chose to honor him by returning to the trampoline park, which was the location of their last adventure together. That seemed fitting. They also asked if there will be wrestling and sword fights in heaven, and I sure hope so. JD, Kit, Sally Jane, Allison, Betty, thank you for sharing Stephen with all of us.
One of the best storytellers I know has decided to come up and share some of his own insights as a father.
Knock, knock. Who's there? That really wasn't very good. Let's try again. Knock, knock.
Who's there?
Interrupting Cal.
Yeah.
Moo! That was one of Stephen's favorite jokes. And it never got old to him. In fact, it got funnier to him every time he told it. And we laughed right along with him. After all, why shouldn't a good joke or a good story get better, especially if you know how it ends? How blessed we've all been to have loved Stephen for 5.5 years. In our family, he was a son, a grandson, a little brother, a big brother, a cousin, a nephew, and a great nephew. What unbridled energy, what unfiltered emotion of all kinds, what pure and simple faith. Kit and I were so privileged to be his parents, as were his three sisters, Sally Jane, Allison, and Betty. Now, my daughter Allison suggested that, rather than being somber today, that each member of our family dress in a different color from the Wordless book. It was Charles Spurgeon book, some of you know. Each color represents a different aspect of the gospel: black for sin, red for Jesus' blood, white for being washed pure, green for new life, and gold for heaven. So later on, see if you can guess which is which. Stephen taught me so much. One of those things was rocket bomb chess. It was a game of his own creation. Now, in rocket bomb chess, the board is set up exactly as it is in conventional chess, but whereas regular chess is largely a game of strategy, rocket bomb chess is much more tactical. You play by launching your chess pieces across the board with the goal of knocking your opponent's pieces off the opposite side. Now, the game has variations. The last time I played with Stephen, he incorporated a set of dice to determine the number of moves you were allowed to make before launching your chess piece across the board. And often the rules changed mid-game, so it was very important to follow closely to Stephen's instructions. In fact, there really was only one static rule to rocket bomb chess, and that's let Stephen win. Last April, we were in Arizona for a family reunion, and Brian and Rose Esterly were kind enough to let us stay with them. Their son, Lewis, really took to Stephen, even though Lewis is several years older. They spent the week together making dozens of clothespins guns from clothespins and rubber bands. You could actually launch little pebbles with them. Now, at the airport on the way home, we passed the Transit Security Administration on our way to dinner. This reminded my oldest daughter, Sally Jane, that she had sadly forgotten her nail clippers in her backpack. Overhearing this, Stephen was very concerned. In a loud voice, he exclaimed, "Daddy, my guns! My backpack is full of guns!" Throughout dinner, Stephen was really worried. He couldn't stop thinking about it. He was going to lose his gift from Lewis. But after we got through the security line, Stephen grabbed his red and black backpack and ran around the corner to make sure his guns were still in there. His guns were not confiscated. Incidentally, somehow they missed Sally Jane's nail clippers, too. Stephen always wanted to help with home projects. I was redoing the powder room downstairs, and he was constantly showing up with his little toolkit that Jonathan Wynn had given him. It had been his. At one point, I handed him my pry bar so he could help pry off a baseboard that needed to come down. He was so happy to be helping with a real project. With the baseboard off, I went back to patching the hardwood floor, and when I stepped back out into the hallway, Stephen, my pry bar in hand, was just about to pull off another baseboard. Except this one wasn't one I'd planned to take off. Just last year, Stephen became part of the Lansdowne Swim Club's mini dolphins team. Just this year, he was so thrilled to be part of a sports team. He took part in one and only one swim meet. But those are some of the best times he enjoyed the last few months of his life. And a lot of you people here were involved in that program. My daughter, Sally Jane, has collected money for World Vision. Among many programs, they collect to provide Bibles and even live chickens to people in need in various parts of the world. Stephen wanted to contribute his entire allowance to the chicken fund until he realized that it wasn't actually rescuing chickens. So instead, he put it all into the Bible fund because he saw that as something very important. The first reaction I had in the emergency room when the doctor told me Stephen couldn't be resuscitated was, but we're not done yet. We got more to do. I had big plans, dreams of sports and graduations and weddings. But God's timing is not ours. And he was telling us that the time had come for Stephen to go home. Today I wanted to remember some of the things that we've delighted in the time that we've had Stephen. But I cannot deny the pain and disappointment I feel. They come at the same time. The Christian life is more than just believing in God, but believing God and taking him at his word. And sometimes this is really, really hard. A friend's child saw his father crying and said, "Daddy, why are you crying? Stephen is in heaven. He's in heaven." As though he'd won a competition. Someone said the rule should be the parents don't bury their children, but maybe in this, like rocket bomb chess, the rules changed so Stephen could finish first. Although we're hurting, one thing I've witnessed is that God's relentless grace can outrun even this kind of loss. And he has told the end of this story, and it's going to get better every time we retell it. I know this side of heaven, we will never fully understand why this had to happen and why we're watching our children and our family go through this loss as well. But we're leaning on Psalm 27:13. "I believe that I shall look upon the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living." Thank you.
Let's pray together, shall we? Let's all pray. Almighty God, our dear Father in heaven, we come to you in the name of your Son, our Savior, our dear Lord Jesus, and with the help and strength of the Holy Spirit. We come to you today against the tide, against the strong tide of raw emotions and the riptide of searing questions that tear away us from you and into danger. As we grieve Stephen's loss today, we wonder about his present state. We wonder at the way of his leaving us. We scrabble around here and there to find a rock to put our feet on. And as we come to you in prayer this morning, we find, as we struggle to find a foothold, a place upon your promises and another place upon your providence. We thank you for your promises, promises that we've trusted in ever since Stephen Little was born. When he came and gave joy to his parents and to his sisters, the joy he brought to his family and friends and to us as his church family. Those gospel promises that have been repeated in his ears and over him in prayer. Those gospel promises that are for us and for our children. We thank you for those promises. We thank you for our Lord Jesus, who bid the disciples let the children come to him. who reminded us that their angels always see the face of our Father in heaven, and that the kingdom of heaven is made up of children who today see you in Christ and in whose joy in your presence is utterly complete. Think of that old hymn, "Before the throne of God in heaven, thousands of children stand, children whose sins are all forgiven, a holy, happy band singing, glory, glory. In flowing robes of spotless white, each see them all arrayed, dwelling in everlasting light and joys that never fade, singing, glory, glory." It encourages us to know that Stephen today lives to God, to you, and lives with God, with you. And we know this because you, our God in Christ, died in our humanity, and that Christ lives and reigns in our humanity as the firstborn among many children. We thank you for the many great and precious promises that you have given to us. And we stand not only on your promises, but we stand upon your providence. That is to say, we reaffirm together today that we believe in you, our good God, that after you created all things, you did not abandon them to chance or fortune, but that you lead and govern everything according to your holy will in such a way that nothing happens in this world without your orderly arrangement. We believe that you are almighty and that you are everywhere present in your power, that as if it was by your own hand you uphold and govern heaven and earth and all creatures, so that herbs and grass and rain and drought and fruitful and barren years and meat and drink and health and sickness and riches and poverty and life and death and all things come not by chance, but by your fatherly hand. Our Lord reminded us that not a sparrow falls to the ground without our Father. We thank you, Lord, for that providence. And without this gospel comfort, or being ignorant of this great providence, leaves us in what John Calvin calls the ultimate of all miseries. But to trust in your providence signals the end of that evil self-responsibility that blames ourselves or distrusts you or tortures our hearts. To trust your providence means rest in God and in God alone. We don't wish today to inquire with undue curiosity into that which is above our pay grade, that which is beyond human understanding, beyond our ability to comprehend. We have to say that you are fire, that you are incomprehensible, ineffable. We cannot get our heads around you. Oh, the depths of the riches of the wisdom and the knowledge of God. You are past finding out. Your thoughts are not our thoughts. Your ways are not our ways. But in all humility and reverence, we adore you. We adore your just judgments, your ways of doing things that are hidden from us. We are striving to be content to be Christ's disciples so as to learn only what he shows us in his word without going beyond those limits. Our Father, today we pray that you would teach us to be patient in this adversity and affliction, as well as thankful in prosperity. Teach us that in all things which have or may hereafter befall us, we might place our firm trust in our faithful God and Father, and be reminded over and over again, just as is true for Stephen, and for his mom and dad, and his sisters, and all of his family, that nothing can separate us from your love. The powers of darkness, the powers of hell, life or death, nothing
can separate us. Nothing in all creation can separate us from your love. We pray that you would comfort us with your truth today. We pray that you would reassure our hearts that at that very instant he died, he was with Christ, which is by far the best. That being absent from the body, he is present with his Lord. That there is a day of resurrection to come, because Jesus rose, so his people shall rise too. And in the meantime, in the language of a much older prayer, we ask, O God, whose never-failing providence orders all things, both in heaven and earth, and we beseech you to put away from us all hurtful things, and to give us those things that are profitable for us, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Thank you. Please be seated. We are here, as has been mentioned, for a number of reasons. We truly are here to mourn with you, J.D., Kit, Sally Jane, Allison, and Betty. You have lost a son. You have lost a brother. We, too, are very sad about what happened, and we're even confused. We love you all, and we miss Stephen with you. We grieve with you. We are also here to try and comfort you. Many of us would say, we don't even know what to say. Sometimes one of the best ways to comfort someone who is very sad is just to be with them. Just to be with them. To remind them they are not alone. And if I could put you on the spot and invite you to stand up and turn around and look. Take a look at who's here. Yes, please do. There's a lot of people here who love you and are with you. Amen. We love you all and we care very deeply for you. And we are especially praying for you. We pray that God would draw near to you, even closer than we could ever do for you. But we are also here, as been mentioned, to celebrate the life of Stephen Little. Even at a young age, he has meant so much to so many people. One of the best ways to celebrate his life is to tell stories. Tell stories about Stephen. Tell his mom and dad and his sisters, along with their aunts and uncles and all their relatives. Tell them stories about Stephen. Many of you have stories to tell. That's one of the best ways to celebrate his life. But one reason we are not here, Kit and JAD and family, to try to take your pain away. This is not one of those pains that easily or even ever goes away. Like I mentioned earlier, we don't even know what to say. Words don't always help, no matter how sincere we are, do they? Time does not heal all wounds. Those are shallow words. It hurts, and we can't take it away, but we are here with you. Stephen Little, even that name brings pictures and memories to many of you. Stephen Little was a blessed child. The Hebrew word for blessed can be interpreted to be envied. Stephen was a child to be envied. Why? Because in the goodness of God, he brought him into your life. Stephen was blessed to be brought into your family. I know it hurts that you've lost him, but what a blessing. God gave Stephen to you. God knew when that child would be born, and God knew when that child would be taken home. He was a gift from God. Stephen was blessed because he was brought into not just any home, but a home, a covenant home, the Bible talks about. A home where the parents unashamedly said, "We love Jesus Christ. We want our children to know about God." Do you know how many children don't have that blessing? How many children are envying being in a home where the things of God are natural and second nature to them? But in his goodness and in his wisdom, he has taken Stephen home. He numbered his days. Yes, he was your child, but even more than that, he was his son. And God said his days are over. The secret things belong to God, and that's a secret we can't wait to find out. But he is with his Lord even now. But Stephen was blessed also because he was a part of the bigger family of God. As has been testified, Stephen loved being around other people who loved Jesus. What a blessing he had upon him. Not only his immediate family, but his church family, other adults, other children were not ashamed to say, "Tell me more about God. I want to understand who Jesus is." Do you know how blessed Stephen Little has been in his 5 brief years of life? He was taught things of God from infancy. Let's not take that for granted. He's a child to be envied. A child to be envied. But also, Stephen Little was a blessing to his family and the world around him. Already, the stories have come. You've heard them, and they're coming more often when you talk to Kit and JT. Even at the age of 5, it's uncanny how already aware of many things he was. My regret is I saw Stephen running the halls. I never had a conversation with little Stephen Little. So I sat down with his parents and said, Kit and JD, let's assume I don't really know Stephen. Who was your son? What was he like? Tell me about him. And we talked for 2 hours. It was wonderful. But here are a few things that I learned about Stephen Little. And the first thing came out of you, Kit. You said he had a sensitive conscience. His mother said, my son had a sensitive conscience. You quoted the fact that at one point he said, Mom, I have something to tell you, but I don't want to. She saw that as a learning opportunity, a teaching moment. And she suggested to him, Kit, to Stephen, Stephen, why don't you write down what you want to say to me, and then we can talk about it. We'll read it. And she overheard him asking for help. How do you spell broke? Again, a teaching moment that was followed up by Kit and JD sitting down with their son, reminding them, yes, it is important to be honest, to confess when you've done something wrong, to ask forgiveness, and especially when it comes to God. What a lesson they taught him about being honest and confessing even your sins to God and asking Jesus to forgive you. What a sensitive conscience of a 5-year-old. He also said, has been mentioned, that he loved to help. I mean, I tried to picture him around that house. You said, whether it was feeding Cody, that's your dog, right? Yeah, good dog. Whether it was feeding Cody or following Mom and Dad around the house with his new toolkit. That toolkit was a special thing to him. He was kind of saying, I want to help. Mom, could you just tell me something to take off the wall? I want to use my screwdriver. And when he realized this saw is real, I can even cut things with it. Watch out for the furniture. He was just ready to help. He wanted to do something. That was Stephen Little. But Stephen Little, I also picked up from you that he was beginning to learn discipline, especially when he passed that deep water test at the pool, remember? And his eyes lit up, his life was changed. I want to be a swimmer. So on his wall in his room was a calendar with all the meets and all the practices. At 5 years of age, the kid's organizing his life and ready to conquer the world. But you also told me he was learning with that sensitive heart to pray. At your family times of devotion where you would read the word and pray together and sing, you would pray. And Stephen would pray for his sisters. And Stephen would pray for his friends at the pool. Stephen wanted to ask God to do good things for his family and for his friends. But just think about that for a moment. Did you hear this? A sensitive heart that wanted to do right and be right with God. A heart that loved to help and to make the most of his days. A heart that saw the need to pray. I want to be like Stephen. I want to be like that 5-year-old who really began to understand the things of God. That's why Stephen Little was and is truly a picture, I think, of what Jesus meant when he talked to those disciples who wanted to, as adults, say, who's going to be the greatest in the kingdom of God? And he said, bring me a child. Bring me a child and put him or her right in the middle of all the other adults. At this point, young people, if you are around Stephen's age or maybe a little younger or older, if you're a teenager or an adult, this might be harder for you to catch. But listen, Jesus is saying to you, young person, in many ways, you are better able to understand what the kingdom of God is like as a child. And that's a precious thing. You are able to see your need as a little child. That child that Jesus put in that midst saw right away, there are big people around me. I'm little, they are big. I need this Jesus. I want to listen to him. I want to trust him, and I want to obey him. Jesus said simply, you must turn and become like a little child. The implication there that Christ is saying is that we are going in one direction, we must turn and go in another one. We have to stop being self-sufficient and become like a child. I can't handle life on my own. I honestly can't. I need help. He equates being a child with humility. Again, he saw how massive the world around him was. And that child, that Stephen, was right there recognizing he needed this Jesus. My friend Stephen is still teaching us. In a sense, he's the real object lesson here. That Jesus, I think, would have said, Stephen, and he is even saying that now. Stephen is in the midst of us, not literally, he is with the Lord God Almighty. But that little life is an object lesson right in the midst of us big adults. Do you understand the kingdom of God? Do you want to understand the kingdom of God? You've got to be like Stephen. You have to stop. You have to look. You have to listen. And I would suggest these times of life, at a funeral or a memorial service like this that are so heavy and so weary, this is one of the few times in life when many of us actually stop and think about death. It's not comfortable, but it's necessary. It's necessary for you and I to stop and think about death. The only place to stop and look, the only voice to listen to in life and in death is the life as the voice of Jesus, that same voice. Stephen spent these few years of his life seeing and listening to the voice of Jesus in his family and in his church family. Stephen was listening to Jesus as a little child who was getting it early on. He loved to learn and to listen. He was in many ways more ready than many of us. Yes, we mourn, grieve, and grieve deeply, but not without hope. Death will not hold Stephen down any more than it held down the Savior himself, the Lord Jesus Christ. The humility that Jesus talks about has to be seen through the eyes of a child. Oh, adults, step back, go back to being a child. Know this, that you and I will never find or know life unless we stop as a child, unless we turn and look to Jesus and listen to him. And as soon as you look and listen at Jesus, you truly stop and see him. Immediately there is something aware in your soul that there is something wrong and something missing in my life, and it is Jesus. That's what Jesus was saying to these disciples. Unless you turn and look at me and really hear me, like a little child, you will never enter the kingdom of God. He truly is what you and I need, not only in death, particularly our own death, but in this life and the world to come. We all must stop, and especially those of us who know that this is not part of our lives. Where is our hope? Where is our life? The call is simply this: be like a little child, be like a Stephen, and turn to Jesus for forgiveness, for life, for eternal life. For he truly is a friend of sinners. He loves us to the end. Amen. Let us pray. Father, we are grateful that you are the Lord God Almighty, and that you give and you take away, but you are good and right in all that you do. In spite of our hearts and aches, you will take even the grief of our soul and give us hope and even life eternal. We thank you that we have seen that in the child of Stephen Little, that little child who was among you and understood what it meant to come into the kingdom of God through trusting in you and loving you simply as a child. Oh God, let us honor Stephen's life, not just in the stories, but in the Savior that he learned so much about. Let us see this Jesus even today. And we pray in Jesus' precious and strong name. Amen.
Thank you.
Before I give the benediction, let me remind you of a few things to be aware of, that following this service, there's a reception that you're invited to tell stories, and the fellowship hall that can be found by going through these two doors in the front and going up the stairs. There are elevators available as well in the reception hall in the building room right behind me as well. Also, we encourage you to pick up your children before you go to the reception. Following this benediction, we invite you to sit down and listen to a musical benediction, and then you'll be dismissed for the reception. But hear now the Lord's benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated.